Good morning. My name is Karen Cruz. I'm a member of the Worship and Music Committee here at First Parish in Plymouth. My pronouns are she, her, and hers, and I want to welcome you today. If you are a visitor and you are not familiar with the building, you can reach out to the ushers for any information that you might need about where things are. Since the pandemic seems to be increasing again, we have a mask policy. That is, we are suggesting everyone mask. But if you don't feel you want to mask, you're welcome to sit over on this side of the congregation, while those people who definitely feel they need to be around others with the mask on will sit over here. The first part of our service is recorded. Following the benediction, the recording will end, and we will go into our candles of joy and concern and our announcements, things that just pertain to our congregation. Since the weather is beautiful today, we can all enjoy a cup of coffee or other beverage or some goodies outside up the driveway to the back. Thank you, Julia Thomas, for organizing that. We are passing the basket for collection, but you can also donate online on our website if you prefer. The service today is led by our pastor, Reverend Art Lavoie, and you are welcome here, whoever you are, whomever you love, whatever you believe, wherever you are on your spiritual journey, you are welcome with us here today. Come walk with us this hour.
Good morning again, everyone. I'm the Reverend Arthur Lavoie. My pronouns are he, him, and his. And I want to offer a special welcome to any of you who are watching this service online, either on Facebook or YouTube or one of the local public access TV stations where this service is broadcast. We are thrilled to have you with us this morning and hope that you enjoy the service. If you want more information about this congregation or Unitarian Universalism, please look at our website, www.firstparishuu.org, and you can find some information there. You can also get a way to contact me or our office if you would like that. So thank you again for being with us. And please enjoy this wonderful day.
Our call to worship is an excerpt from Blessing When the World Is Ending by Jan Richardson. There is nothing that comes out more for a blessing than when the world is falling apart. This blessing will not fix you, will not mend you, will not give you false comfort. It will simply sit itself beside you among the shards and gently turn your face toward the direction from which the light will come as the world begins again.
For our first hymn, I'm not using the one that's listed in your order of service. I couldn't find a good recording of that that has the UU verses. What we are going to sing is a very simple chant, and the words are, "From you I receive, to you I give. Together we share, and by this we live."
Thank you.
Please rise. Please be seated. And for all ages, that's
me too.
That's right, the chalice entrance. Okay. Never mind.
Thank you.
So I'm going to ask you to rise again and join me in the words of the chalice lighting. Love is the spirit of this church, and service its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in freedom, to speak the truth in love, and to tell one another. Please be seated. Time for all ages. As I mentioned, Deb is taking a Sunday off today. So our theme for the month of June is about celebrating our blessings and how we kind of find blessings, how we celebrate blessings. And, you know, blessings, well, that's a religious term, a spiritual term that we tend not to use very much. You know, especially for the kids that are here today, you might not know or might not have used that word or know what a blessing is. So we're going to talk about that for a few minutes. And what comes to mind? Anybody would like to respond to the word blessing? Something that makes us feel fortunate. Yes.
Something that feels like a gift from the universe.
Something that feels like a gift from the universe. Mm-hmm. Something that maybe makes us tingle inside a little bit. You know? Something surprising that we see. Maybe it's, you know, I'm going to mention in my sermon, I've been surprised and thrilled to see bunnies in my backyard this spring and summer. And now there are a couple of little ones along with the two adult bunnies that have been there that are just like thrill me every time I see them. You know, blessings sometimes are also when we do something for other people, whether they acknowledge it or not. Sometimes when we help people out, we feel good inside for doing that. You know, we think, oh, that person needed this help. Maybe it's helping, you know, kids. Maybe it's helping your parents around the house, picking up your toys. And don't do it with a frown on your face. Do it because you want to help out. And you feel good for doing it, and hopefully your parents will thank you. So blessings are also things that we give to other people that make us feel good inside
whether or not they get acknowledged, whether or not somebody thanks us for them. The thanking is just an extra blessing on top of it, right? And blessings can happen anytime and anywhere, and if we spend all of our time just worried about what's going on in our lives, then we miss a lot of what's going on. We miss something that we might see just as we're walking around outside, even, that make us feel good inside, and that's what a blessing is. Okay. So I will ask the kids to go with Emily, and I think the little ones are already up there. Some of the, with Jordan, so the littlest ones. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Our reading comes from Sense of Blessing by Reverend Peter Friedrichs. I know what a blessing looks like. And I'm not talking about a picture of the Pope placing his cupped hands on a child's head. It looks like the midnight delivery of a stunned and wide-eyed Indian orphan to her adoptive parents at the baggage claim carousel in Terminal E of Logan Airport. And a full moon rising over Mount Katahdin out of an autumn night so clear and cold that makes your teeth ache. I know what a blessing smells like, too. The head of your one-month-old niece thrust into your arms by your dead, tired sister who wants nothing more than a few hours of uninterrupted sleep. And the aroma of fresh-baked bread that catches you off guard as you walk past a bakery, your head bowed against the cold and the grief on the way to your grandmother's funeral. A blessing tastes like the cherry popsicles you used to share with your dad on the front stoop just before bedtime in the summer, when the light was soft and the pavement was still warm under your toes. The deafening roar of a water cascading into an Ithacan gorge is the sound of a blessing. And two, the silence of the pre-dawn forest when the insects have gone to ground and birds have not yet begun to bid the morning welcome. And I know, thank God, I know how a blessing feels, like walking out of the shadow of a skyscraper or your own fear and feeling the sun on your face for the first time in forever. And waking up every morning next to the person who saved your life.
Our musical reflection, you will be found, the author's names are in your order of service. It comes from the musical Dear Evan Hansen. when I lived in Dorchester, when I was the minister there, there was a patch of lawn next to the driveway. I called it the croquet lawn because it was large enough and flat enough to set up a croquet set. Every year in early March, when the ground still had some snow cover and seemed frozen, when everything was brown and bleak, crocuses would bloom all over that lawn. I lived in that house for 10 years, and every March I would be shocked, surprised, and filled with awe and wonder the morning I looked out the window and saw those purple buds. They always came unexpectedly. It seemed too soon. How could these fragile blossoms survive in the snow and cold? How had they broken through the frozen ground? Blessings are like that. They break through some frozen ground we have put around our hearts and souls. They bring a smile to our faces. They can cause us to stop in our tracks, fill us with wide-eyed wonder, give us pause to look, to listen, or to feel more deeply. They can flood us with a warmth and a gratitude. As Peter Friedrichs describes in our reading, blessings often come to us through our senses. We see, hear, feel, taste, and touch things that make us smile and can shake us up a bit. I once had a friend who, after a particularly good meal, would declare, "Ah, that was a TBO, a taste bud orgasm." That's what blessings are like. Blessings are there all around us, whether we choose to let them in or not. Sometimes we cling to our grief and sorrow. Sometimes we are caught up in the struggles of our lives and the violence we see around us. It can be easy to stay in that place feeling angry, resentful, overwhelmed. But that only locks us into a cycle of our own destruction. That cycle of grief and isolation and rage and struggle, those emotions have been very real for us these last couple of years. Between the pandemic and the political turmoil, the uncertainty we feel and the lack of civility around us, the war in Ukraine, the worsening climate crisis, and the increase in mass shootings. There is so much that weighs on our hearts. Many of us have heard and used the phrase COVID fatigue to describe our state of mind these days. We perhaps take more chances than we did a year ago, because we're tired of being so cautious, and we're tired of not being social. There is another phrase I've heard recently, violence fatigue. Phrase that's starting to emerge these days. At what point does the verbal violence we hear and the violence around us, the mass shootings that seem to be happening on a weekly basis this month and last, at what point do these have less of an impact? Because we've almost grown to expect them. The Reverend Rob Hardies writes, "There are times in our lives when it feels like things are falling apart, when loss strips our days of joy, when death robs us of someone we love, or violence shatters our sense of security, when war, genocide, and injustice lead us to the brink of despair. Life has a way sometimes of bringing us to our knees, but we can't remain in that place of grief and rage, that place of being lost and overwhelmed for long. Those things will never save us or give us meaning and purpose. We need to move beyond those feelings to some kind of action. Finding, looking for, celebrating our blessings are a key to making that transition. Awareness of our blessings shifts our focus and offers some healing relief to what in us has been damaged and broken. Blessings are not always a startling surprise. Sometimes we anticipate or expect them. Perhaps seeking them out when we need something to lift our spirits. How many of us have called a friend when we're feeling particularly down, called a friend or a loved one to chat in order to feel better, in order to get that blessing or that connection with them? Sometimes when I need a lift, I take a longer walk home. I live over here on Summer Street, and I walk down by Jenny Pond so that I can look for the swans. And that is sometimes enough to make me feel better, especially if I can find them. If I can't find them, then of course I'm worried about the swans. Throughout the day, I'm often looking to see what birds are at my feeders. Toward the end of the day, I anticipate that I might see bunnies in the yard. When I come here on Sunday mornings, I look forward to seeing and talking with all of you. Even though anticipated, these are still blessings because they touch me and move me and invite me to open my heart just a bit more. One of the best pieces of advice, by the way, that we get about living a healthy life comes from the airline stewards when they make the safety announcement before the plane takes off. In an emergency, please remember to put on your own oxygen mask before attempting to help someone else with theirs. This has been a time of multiple emergencies, and there are so many ways we feel pulled and compelled to be present to others, to share our voice and resources. But if we don't take care of ourselves first, if we don't seek out the spiritual support and blessings from those people and things that nurture and bless us, then we won't have the energy, the oxygen, if you will, to respond to others. Now that we have been touched by blessings, we are called upon to give blessings to others. It's not a difficult task, and we don't often realize when we do it. We just have to show up. Perhaps offer a word of comfort or even a hello to someone we pass on the street. a recognition that the other person we encounter is worthy of our attention. We only have to ask how someone is and actually want to listen to their story. There is no greater blessing than to be seen, heard, and acknowledged, especially when people feel alone and lost and overwhelmed, which so many are feeling right now. Reverend Alea Kenton writes, "So what then does it mean to offer a blessing or to be a blessing? To bless something or someone is to invoke its wholeness, to help remind the person or thing you are blessing of its essence, its sacredness, its beauty, and to help remind yourself of that too. Blessing does not fix anything. It's not a cure. A blessing does not fix us. It does not instill health or well-being or strength. Instead, it reminds us that those things are already there within us. My colleague, the Reverend Kathleen McTeague, tells of an encounter she had in a grocery store on the day after her father died. She writes, "When I arrived at the checkout and the clerk distractedly said, 'How are you?' my brain went blank. I couldn't say fine or even okay. To my horror, I found myself blurting out a real and honest answer. 'I'm not so good,' I said. 'My dad died last night.' I was mortified at having revealed to an unprepared stranger just how not fine I was. Everyone froze in this moment of uncomfortable paralysis, except the young man bagging the groceries, who had Down syndrome. He stopped moving completely, looked straight at me, and with a little slur and great emphasis said, 'I bet you feel really sad about that.' Yes, I do, thank you, I said to him. I thought about that encounter for a long time. The young man bagging groceries would be considered disabled in thought, speech, and movement. Yet he was the only one able to offer what counted in that particular moment. He knew how to give a blessing. Okay. I think we need to be more like those amazing crocuses. They seem so fragile when they push through the frozen ground as harbingers of spring. But they are also strong and fearless and resilient and beautiful. They gather their internal resources through the winter, and they do that together. I've never seen a single solitary crocus. There's always a clump or a field of them. In whatever plant-like way, I imagine they support each other in their magnificent call to new life. So I invite us all this summer to begin to reflect on the treasures, the blessings that we seek, and the places in everyday life where we might find them. Do all the things that you might regularly be tempted to do go to the beach, walk, or bike ride around your neighborhood or some other beautiful natural place. Spend time with family and friends. Do them cautiously and carefully and safely. Whatever we do, let's do it with a new vision of what it might offer to your questioning and questing spirit. And then when we are filled with the blessings that nurture us and give us strength and resilience, we can have the courage and the stamina for the work ahead. For there is much good work we are called to do. Many great blessings we are called upon to share and to be for each other in this very broken world around us. Amen. And blessed be. So our closing hymn, the words are printed in your order of service for All That Is Our Life. I found a recording of the UU choir singing that. Please rise in body or in spirit. Seated for our benediction, which comes from the words of Jan Richardson in the book Circle of Grace. If you would enter into the wilderness, do not begin without blessing. Do not leave without hearing who you are, beloved. Named by the one who has traveled this path before you. Do not go without letting this echo in your ears, and if you find it is hard to let it into your heart, do not despair. That is what the journey is for. I cannot promise this blessing will free you from danger, from fear, from hunger or thirst, from the scorching of sun or the fall of the night. But I can tell you that on this path there will be help. I can tell you that on this way there will be rest. I can tell you that you will know the strange graces that come to our aid only on a road such as this, that fly to meet us bearing comfort and strength, that come alongside us for no other cause than to lean themselves toward our ear and with their curious insistence whisper our name.